Hey, what's up, guys? I'm back here again to answer some popular inorganic chemistry questions. If you haven't checked my previous videos, do well to check my channel. And remember, if you have any question, try and drop it in the comment box down below. So as usual, I'm going to display the question, explain the topic, then answer the question proper. So let's jump into it. The first question we have here, question 1A, says that write short note on Jantella theorem, as we are aware that the Jantella theorem have to do with complexes, and these complexes comprise of central metal and ligands. It is believed that this central metal is made up of a d orbital, and these d orbitals are 5 in number. We have, and these 5 d orbitals are dxy, dxz, dyz, d x square, y square, and d z square. And it is believed that these 5 orbitals all are always linear, right? It makes the central metal to be linear, and they have the same energy. They have the same energy, or you can say they have equal energy. And but what happens if the shape of the molecule or the shape of this central metal change? It's no more linear, since we say that the central metal now is linear. That's why they have the same energy. What if it changes? So Jantella's theorem states that any non-linear molecule system in a degenerate electrostatic state will be unstable and will undergo distortion to form a stable molecule or lower energy system, thereby removing the degeneracy. What is all this grammar about? It's trying to tell us that this orbital is linear. That's why they are in degenerate state. What is degenerate state? They have the same energy level. Is that not? Since they have the same energy level, that's why they are linear, then nothing will happen. But what if ligands approach? That means that metal is it's going to form a complex, and as we know, the complex are not linear in shape. As a result of that, there will be distortion, and this distortion now is due to repulsion of the electrons from the ligands and that of the metals. So this distortion now will now cause a splitting. It will now cause the degeneracy, the equal energy, to be broken. Then these orbitals now will separate, and that equal energy now will be lost. In order for the molecule now, it's no more metal, for the molecule to be stable. So let's state the Jantella theorem. We say that so that's the theorem. It states that any non-linear molecule in degenerate state will be unstable and will undergo distortion to form a stable molecule or lower energy system, thereby removing degeneracy. All this breaking of the degeneracy is for the molecule to be stable, right? So once ligands approach this metal to form a molecule, the d orbitals that were always having the same energy will no more have the same energy. Why? Because there will be distortion. It will scatter them off. Some will go higher in energy, while some will go lower in energy. So let's try to see how this d orbital will be splitted. So at first, they have the same energy. They are having degenerate. They say they are degenerate. They have the degeneracy. But once these ligands approach to form molecule, they will be raised in energy. They will rise in energy, average energy, and we have them here. So this is for a free metal. This one here. Free metal ion is for the average energy. So now remember that the d orbitals have this shape. So when these ligands approach, it is believed that, especially octahedral, it is believed that those orbitals that are on the axis, that is these ones, can you see they are on the line, apart from these ones that are, these ones are in between the axis, right? These ones are in between the axis. But those ones that are on the axis will go higher in energy. So it will, they will split, the degeneracy will be removed. So these ones that are on the axis are actually the dx square, y square, and the dz. And the remaining three will have lower energy compared to the average energy. When the orbitals are in free metal ion, they are linear, they have degeneracy. But once these ligands approach, they go higher in average energy, then they will split. Remember that these ones are on the axis, right? That's why. While these ones are between the axis, that's why they are lower in energy. So, but reverse is the case in that of tetrahedral. In that of tetrahedral, once they approach, this is what happened. Then they split. In times of the tetrahedral, they are going, those ones that were on the axis are believed to be in between the axis. So it will be opposite. This one will go, those ones that will, this one say will now go higher in energy. Since now in the tetrahedral they are believed to be on the axis, so we have lower energy because now they are in between the axis. Sorry, there was a mistake here. This is dx square y square. So that is all about the John Tyler. Remember that this one is for octahedral, so we call it the octahedral splitting octahedral, right? Then this one is for the tetrahedral. So don't forget about the theory, which states that any non-linear molecule will undergo distortion and it will cause the d orbitals to split, thereby removing their degeneracy in order for the molecule to be stable. Alright, number 1b says that draw the schematic figure to show the splitting of d orbitals in both octahedral and tetrahedral. This is a very simple question because we've already seen that in the John Tyler distortion theory or in the John Tyler theory. But since it's a question, we're going to still answer it for more understanding, right? So let's jump into it. All right, we're going to start with that of the octahedral. So let's see the octahedral first. So let's assume this is energy. Now, as we said in the octahedral, the free metal is usually having degeneracy, right? So the 5d orbitals are always low in energy, having the same energy level. Degeneracy is there, they are degenerates. So we have them here. So this is the free metal ion we have, and these orbitals are dxy. So this is the free metal ion, right? They are still having their degeneracy. So when these ligands approach, they're going to go average in energy higher. So when they go higher in energy, we're going to have something like this. As the ligand approach, there will be repulsion between the d orbitals electrons and the ligands electron. And since, as we said, these x square y square are on the axis, and the dz square, they will go higher in energy. So we have them here. And since the dyx, dxz, and dyz are in between the axis, they will go lower in energy. So this is for the octahedral. So now we are going to say that the splitting here, that's the splitting, of course, from here. And this is the energy, as we said. Can you see? Then this one here will be 2 out of 5, and the other one is going to be 3 out of 5. they've gone out of the three, two have gone. This is the octahedral splitting, and as we said, that this is the average energy of the d orbital. Then this is the splitting of the d orbital for octahedra. So this is actually the splitting for all octahedral complexes. So let's see that of the tetrahedral. So for the tetrahedral, we have the energy. So in this case, we have the free metal ion here, the same thing. So once the ligands approach, they are going to go average in energy. So in this case now, the dx square, y square, and the dz square are no more on the axis in the tetrahedral. They are in between the axis, so they will go lower in energy. But the dxy, dxz, and dyz are now on the axis, so they will be higher in energy. So it's just the opposite of the octahedral. So we have something like this. Then this one will go lower. So this is actually the tetrahedral splitting. So this one will be 2 out of 5, and this one will be 3 out of 5. So this one will say free metal ion, and this is average energy of d orbitals. Then this is the splitting of the d orbitals in tetrahedral. So this is actually for tetrahedral. So that's all for the question. Let's move to the next question. Alright, our second question is, for each of the following complexes, give the IUPAC nomenclature, the oxidation state of your central metal, the number of unpaired electrons, and determine the spin-only magnetic moment. So this is actually four questions in one. These are the complexes that we're going to give the IUPAC nomenclature, the oxidation state of central metal, the number of unpaired electrons, and determine the spin-only magnetic moment. In this question, I'm not going to use the valence bond theorem, but rather I'm going to use the crystal field theory. So let's pick this complex one after the other to answer them, right? So let's give it a try. All right, this is the first complex we have. So as we know that we can't start naming the complex without calculating the oxidation state of the central metal. So let's solve the first question by calculating the oxidation state of the central metal. As you know that the central metal is our unknown. So X plus this ligand water is usually zero, doesn't have any charge. So we said plus zero times six of them will now equate to the charge of the ion, which is positive 3, so equals to plus 3, right? So we have X plus 6 times 0 is 0, equals to positive 3. So X is equals to plus 3. So that's the oxidation state of the central metal. We've answered part of the question. Now, in the nomenclature now, the first thing to check is the type of ligand, because we're going to name the ligands first. Of course, the type of complex, if it is a cation or an anion, because we usually name the cations first, that's the positive complex, right? Then we'll check the central metal. If the central metal is in an anion, it will still retain its name. But if it is in the cation, we will now use the Latin name and ending up with ATE. So since this one is an ion, right? It's an ion, but it's positive ion, the central metal is going to still retain its name. So the name of this complex is, and don't forget that water is known as aqua. We're not going to use water here, and there are six of them. So six of the water is hexa. So the nomenclature of this complex is going to be hexa aqua. Why? Because there are six water. Then we have cobalt, the central metal, right? Since we used to name the ligands before the central metal, cobalt. And what is the oxidation state of the central metal? It is plus 3. So we say 1, 2, 3. So 1, 2, 3, and it's an ion because it possesses charge, right? So we say ion. So this is hexa, aqua, cobalt, 3 iron. So the next question is to calculate or to find out the number of unpaired electrons. And before finding the number of unpaired electrons, it will be you have to know the electronic configuration of the central metal. And the electronic configuration of this cobalt is, in case you don't know how to write the electronic configuration, you can check my other videos. I have a video, I have a video on that. 7, then we have 4s2. So that's the electronic conversion of this cobalt. And since cobalt is positive 3, that means it's going to lose 3 electrons, right? So losing the 3 electrons, as we know, is going to, we have to cancel 2 from here and 1 from here. So this one will remain 6. So the new electronic configuration of cobalt now is going to be. The next thing to check is the type of ligand. Water is actually a weak field ligand, right? So that means it's not going to force pairing of the electrons. So we say water is weak field ligand, weak field. So now, and the next thing to consider is the geometry of the complex. And the geometry of this complex is actually octahedral. Why? Because it's having 6 ligands here. So since it's having 6 ligands, we're going to use the knowledge of the crystal filter that we've earlier seen in the previous question. So for octahedral splitting, we're going to have something like this. So there are how many electrons in the d octal? There are 6 electrons. So we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So since water is a weak field ligand, so we're going to enter, as we know that this is the T2G and this is the EG, right? So since water is a weak field ligand, we'll enter it singly before pairing. 6 electrons, right? And see these 6 electrons. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So can you see? So what's the number of unpaired electrons? It's equal to, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. There are 4 unpaired electrons there. So 4. Then the next question is to calculate the spin only magnetic moment. So, and we know that the spin magnetic moment is given as mu is equals to the square root of n into n plus 2, where n is equals to number of unpaired electrons. And how many unpaired electrons we have? We have 4 of them. So we're going to substitute. It's going to be 4 into 4 plus 2, which will be the square root of 4 plus 2 is 6. So 6 giving us the square root 4.9. So if you are to predict the magnetic nature, this complex is going to be paramagnetic. Why? Because of the presence of these unpaired electrons. As you know, that paramagnetism is all about unpaired electrons, even though the question did not ask us to find out the type of magnetism. But in case you have any question like that, know that it will be paramagnetic due to the presence of unpaired electrons. So let's see the next complex. All right, this is the second complex that we have to give the IUPAC name, the oxidation state of a central metal, the number of unpaired electrons, and the spin only magnetic moment. So the first thing, as usual, is to calculate the oxidation state of a central metal. Remember that potassium is positive 1, so we have 1, 3 of them, then plus our central metal, which is X, we don't know it. Then chlorine is usually minus 1, so it's going to be minus 1 times 4. So this metal is actually neutral, will equate to 0, right? So we have 3 plus X minus 4 equals to 0, because minus 1 time is 4 is 4 minus 4. So collecting like terms, we'll have x plus 3 minus 4 equals to 0. So it's going to be 3 minus 4 is going to be minus 1, right? So equals to 0. So we have that x is equal to plus 1. So that's the oxidation state of the central metal. So now, in naming this complex, know that the complex itself is an anion, right? It's an anion. Why? Because there is this potassium, which is a cation, and is known as a counter ion. So it's trying to tell you that this complex is negatively charged. That's why this positively charged potassium is there to counter that negative charge. So if that's the case, we're going to name the potassium first. Why? Because it is the cation. Then we will now name the complex, which is an anion. And in name the anion, we will have to name the ligands first because the complex. Then the central metal will end up with a suffix of ATE, since it is an anion. So this one will be potassium. Then we have 4 chlorines, right? So it's going to be tetrachloro. Then the central metal, which is copper, now it will end up with ATE, will be cuprate. And what's the oxidation state of the central metal? 1, right? So cuprate 1, since it's not an ion, that's the name of the complex: potassium tetrachlorocuprate 1. So the next thing is to calculate the number of unpaired electrons. But before calculating the number of unpaired electrons, we have to write the electronic configuration of copper. Remember that copper and chromium have exception in electronic configuration. If you want to know the reason, I have a video on that. You can do well to check my channel. So remember that it has the central metal has lost one electron. So we're going to subtract, cancel one electron. So cancel this electron, we'll be left with argon 3d10. So the next thing is this ligand. What type of ligand is this? Chlorine is actually a weak field ligand, right? It's usually a weak field ligand, and therefore it's not going to force pairing. It's going to enter it singly. And next thing to check is the geometry. The geometry of this complex is tetrahedral. Why? Because it's having 4 ligands. So since it is a tetrahedra, we're going to use the tetrahedral splitting, as we've seen, that is the opposite of the octahedral splitting. So we're going to enter it singly. These 10 electrons will enter it singly, since chlorine is a weak field ligand. So we have 10 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So how many number of unpaired electrons do we have? It said number of electrons is equal to 0, because there is no any unpaired electron. Then the last question is the spin only magnetic moment. So will be what we know, the formula is equal to the square root of n into n plus 2. So where our n is the number of unpaired electrons. And how many unpaired electrons do we have? We have 0. So what do you think will happen? This one will be 0 into n into 0 plus 2, which is equal to 0. So our spin only magnetic moment is 0. Therefore, this complex will be diamagnetic. There is no unpaired electrons, right? Therefore, this complex is diamagnetic. So that's all for this. Let's try the last one. So this is the last complex we're having, and this complex happens to be a negative ion, right? Since it's a negative ion, it's trying to tell the entire system here is a negative ion. That means the central metal is going to have a Latin name, and it's going to end up with ATE. Remember, because we said that all anions will what? Will, the central metal will end up with ATE. So let's calculate the oxidation state of the central metal. So X plus the cyanide is usually minus 1 will equals to the charge of this complex, so minus 4. So we have that X minus 6 equals to minus 4, and X is equals to minus 4 plus 6. So therefore, minus 4 plus 6 is plus 2. That's the oxidation state of the central metal. So as usual, what would be the name of this complex? Of course, it's a negative complex, negative ion. So we're going to say, naming from the ligand, we have 6 of them, which is hexa. So we say hexacyano. Now it's not going to be ion. Why? It's going to be ferrite, because it's a negative complex. So with anion complex, so it's going to be ferrite, cyanoferrite. Cyanoferrite. How many ions we have? How many? We have 3. Sorry, 2. See the oxidation state of central metal ions. Ferrite. 2 now is an ion. So you have to end the name with ion. So hexacyanoferrite 2 ion. Then the next thing is to calculate the unpaired or predict the number of unpaired electrons. And before we do that, we'll have to know the electronic configuration of ion. And the electronic configuration of ion, so as we say, it is going to lose 2 electrons, right? So 2 electrons gone. Then the new electronic configuration of ion is going to be what? It's going to be argon 3d6. So what type of ligand is cyanide? You know, cyanide is a strong field ligand, so it's going to force the pairing of electrons. And the geometry of this complex is actually octahedral. Why? Because it's having 6 ligands. So let's draw the splitting of octahedral. So we're going to have, and how many electrons we have here? We have 6 electrons. 1, 2, 5, and 6. And remember, cyanide is a strong field, so we'll force the pairing of this electron. So we're going to enter it paired up. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6. Can you see? So the number of unpaired electron is going to be what? 0. And the next thing is our spin only magnetic moment. So magnetic moment will be mu is equals to n into n plus 2. And what's n? N is number of unpaired electron, which is 0. So it's going to be the root of 0 into 0 plus 2, which is 0. So this complex is going to be diamagnetic, since the spin only moment, magnetic moment, is 0. So that's all for this question. So let's go to the next question. Alright, the third question we are having here is a very simple question. It says that explain the reason for the following. That this complex here is paramagnetic while this is not. Right, that's the first part. Then the second part here is that the color of the solution of this complex is green while the solution of this complex is not. So I'm still going to use the crystal field theory to explain this. So I'm going to carry the question one after the other. Let's solve the first part that have to do with paramagnetism. Right, all right let's solve the question and explain the reason why the first one is paramagnetic while the second one is not. So the first thing to do is to calculate the oxidation state of both the complexes. So this one is going to be X plus, as we know, ammonia is usually neutral, which is 0 times 6 is equal to the charge of this ion. So will be equal to plus 3 So which is x is equals to 0 times 6 is 0, which is plus 3. So that's the oxidation state of this central metal. So the next thing to do is to draw the electronic configuration of chromium, right? So chromium, as we said, this is the oxidation state of the central metal. Chromium is argon 3d5. It's also one of those metals that have exception to the electronic configuration 4s1. So since it's losing 3 electrons, we're going to remove one from the 4s and one from the 3d. So let's do that. One out here and 2 there. So we're going to be left with 3, right? We're going to be left with 3. So the new electronic configuration now is going to be, check the type of ligand. The type of ligand here is a weak field ligand and it is octahedral. So let's draw the octahedral splitting. You know that it's going to be like this. So the type of ligand, as we said, it's a weak field ligand, right? NH3, weak. So there will be no force pairing. So we're going to enter it singly, the 3 electrons. 3, right? Can you see? This is having 3 unpaired electrons. 3 unpaired electrons. But we're not going to conclude, but all that we know here is that this one will be what? Paramagnetic. Since paramagnetism have to do with unpaired electrons, it has 3 unpaired electrons. So let's solve the other part of the question. Nickel, we want to first calculate the oxidation state of nickel, which is now X plus cyano group is usually minus 1. So we have minus 1. Plus 2. So that's the oxidation state of this central metal. So the next thing is to check the type of ligand. You know that Cn is a strong field. And this, the geometry of this one is tetrahedral because I want 4 complexes, right? So we're going to use the tetrahedral splitting. We'll have something like this. So since it's a strong field ligand, we are going to pair it, right? We're going to pair it, but before doing that, we have to write the electronic configuration of nickel. And nickel is something like this. 3d8 and 4s2. So since it's going to lose 2 electrons, we're going to cancel 2 electrons now. So just from this 4s. So we'll be having 8 electrons now. So the new electronic configuration is argon 3d8. So entering the 8 electrons, this is the 8 electrons. So we're going to enter them paired. Why? Because cyanide is a strong field ligand. So we're going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So how many unpaired electrons? 0 electrons. So can you see the reason? So the reason here is that this complex is having 3 unpaired electrons, while the second complex, this one here, has 0 unpaired electrons. So that's the reason. The reason here is that there are 3 unpaired electrons here, and the ligand is a weak field ligand, while here there are 0 unpaired electrons, and the ligand is a strong field ligand. So that's all for this explanation. Let's go to the second part of this question. Alright, this is the second part of the question. The question says that this complex, the ion is green, while this one is colorless. And the question says why we should explain, right? So if we are going to explain this, we have to now calculate the unpaired electrons, and we'll see whether which one will give us color and which one the ion will not give us color. So let's calculate the oxidation state of this one, which will be X plus the water is 0 times 6 equals to the charge of this, which is plus 2 or positive 2. Positive 2. So we have x is equal to plus 2. And the electronic configuration of nickel, as we know, this is the oxidation cell, right? It's going to be, is always nickel, argon, 3D8 and 4S2. So we're going to remove two electrons since it's going to lose two electrons. Positive 2 means it's going to lose two electrons. So two electrons from here, and our new electronic configuration is going to be argon 3D8. And water here is a weak field ligand, and this is a octahedral. So we're going to use octahedral splitting for weak field, right? These 8 electrons, we're going to fill them. So let's draw it and see. 1, 2. So water is a weak field ligand, right? So it's going to enter singly. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and we have 2 unpaired electrons. So there are 2 unpaired electrons, right? So we'll say electrons. So let's solve the second part or the other pair of the question. So we know that nickel is x plus cyanide. The cyanide group is always have -1 × 4. So this is the oxidation state of nickel, right? So the next thing is the electronic configuration of nickel, so that we can remove two electrons since it's donating two electrons. So we know that nickel, so how many electrons? Two electrons, losing two electrons, so we cancel this electron. Then our new electronic configuration is going to be nickel equals to 3D8. So we know that cyanide is what? It's a strong field ligand, and this indicates that this complex is tetrahedral, right? So what are we going to do? Since it's tetrahedral, what we're going to do, we are going to use the tetrahedral splitting, which is always the opposite of the octahedral splitting. This is for the tetrahedral, opposite of the octahedral. This is the T2G and the EG. So how many electrons do we have? We have 8 electrons after subtracting the 2 electrons, because it gives out 2 electrons, right? So as a result of that, we're going to say 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So since this cyanide is a strong field ligand, it's going to force the pairing of these 8 electrons. So we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So how many unpaired electrons? 0. I have 0 unpaired electrons. So what would be our conclusion? Now this one that have 0 unpaired electron, we're going to say what? Due to the absence of unpaired electrons, there will be no DD transition. And you know, DD transition, that's, we're talking about the D orbital transition, the electrons jumping from one orbital to another. When they are unpaired, generally, we believe that there might be at some point DD transition. That means the electrons jumping from one orbital to another. And whenever an electron jumps from one orbital to another, it is said to produce colored ion, because there will be absorption of light, right? See, you know, whenever an electron jumps from one point to another, it's going to gain energy, and whenever it drops down, it's going to release energy. So therefore there will be absorption. But in this case, since we have 0 unpaired electron, this one will be colorless, and this one that have 2 unpaired electron, there is high possibility of d orbital transition, that's dd transition. So there will be dd transition. So there will be dd transition. As a result of that, it will absorb light and produce color. That's why the question says that this complex here is green, but this one here is colorless. right? So that's the explanation to this. Just know that it is as a result of the absence of unpaired electrons. That's why this one will be colorless and there will be no d-d transition, while this there is presence of two unpaired electrons, which may lead to d-d transition and thereby producing colored ion. So that's all for this question. All right, the fourth question says that write the formula and names of the following compounds. We have some funny names and funny complexes formulas here. The first one says tetraamine diaquacobalt 3 chloride. Then the third one is potassium tetracyanonucleate 2. Then the third one is tris-ethane-1,2-diamine chromium 3 chloride. Then from the fourth one to the sixth one are complexes formulas that we're going to name. So let's try it and see. I'm going to pick it one after the other, right? So let's start with the tetraamine diaquacobalt 3 chloride. So the first complex we have here, or the compound, is tetraamine diaquacobalt 3 chloride. So the first thing to do is try and extract the ligands. So we know we have the first one here is tetraamine, right? So tetraamine, that means we have four of the amine group. So just write it here, four of the amine group. Then we have diaqua, that's two water, right? So we have water, so we have two water, two of it, right? Then the central metal is cobalt, right? Then we'll write cobalt. So this question is trying to tell you that the complex itself is an anion. Then this is the cation. So let's try and fix the complex now first. Then we'll calculate the oxidation state. Then if we did not get 3, then we'll know what we are going to do. So try and arrange the complex, remember, in such a way that the metal will come first. So we have something like this, cobalt first, right? Then we have tetraamine, then we have the water. So since this chloride is the anion and is the counterion, we'll write it here. We will write it here. But remember, it is 3. So try calculating the oxidation state of this central metal. If we do not get 3, then we are going to balance it from here, right? So let's see. So this one is going to be X plus, of course, ammonia is 0 and water is 0. Then plus this chlorine is minus 1. So it's going to give us 0. So X minus 1 equals to 0. X is equals to plus 1. So you can see that the oxidation state is not this 3. So what we're going to do, we are simply going to add 2 to this. We are simply going to add 3 to this. By the time we add 3, we are simply going to add 3 to this. By the time we add 3, this place will be negative 3. And at the end, we're going to have what? We're going to have negative 3 and positive 3 here. So as a result of that, so the best thing is to add 3 here. By the time you add 3, try calculating the oxidation. So it's going to be X plus 0 plus 0 minus 3, because this one is 1 times 3, minus 1 times 3, right? Since negative 1 equals to 0, then X is equals to plus 3. Of course, it's giving us the same chart with this. So that's the formula. The formula for tetraamine diaquacobalt 3 chloride. So let's see the next complex. What's the next compound? So this is the second compound. As usual, let's bring out the ligands. So we have potassium. Potassium will be the counterion since it is named first. So it will be the cation. So we have potassium here, right? Then we have tetracyano. So there are four of the cyano group. Try to put them here. Then we have nucleate. That means this complex from here to here is the negatively charge complex, or we can say is the cation of the system. So we have nickel, that's nickel, but it is in the negative form. So try putting them together. Remember that this one is the cation, so we are going to put it outside the system. So we have potassium. We are not going to balance it yet until we finish. Tetracyanonickel. So the central metal first here. Then we have the cyano tetra, right? Then we have something like this. So try calculating the oxidation state of this system of the central metal. If we do not get 2, then we'll add something to this counter ion, because it's going to counter the charge. Whatsoever we get there, we get here, this one will counter it. Let's see, we have 1 because potassium is 1 plus central metal X, then plus our cyano is usually minus 1, so minus 1 times 4. So we're going to have, then that means it's not correct with this. So we have to add a counter ion that will counter this charge. So by the time we add 2 here, right, we know that this one here will be 2, and it's going to be 2 minus, or which will be minus 2, and we're going to get 2 here. So the best thing is to add 2 here. So by the time we add 2 here, calculate the oxidation state and see, we're going to have 2 now plus X. So if we put 2 to this potassium now, let's see, 2 plus X. X equals to plus 2. So plus 2 and these 2 is the same. So that's the name of our compound. So let's go to the next one. So this is the next compound. Trace a 10-1-2 diamine chromium 3 chloride. So it's trying to tell you that this is the cation and chloride is the anion. So in this case, let's extract the ligands. You know that this trace means 3, because this one is already having dye in it. That's why we usually use 3. So we'll have 3 of these 18. So we have 3. And we have chromium as a central metal. Then that's for the complex. Then remember that this one will be a counterion. So we're going to have something like this. So don't write anything yet. Let's calculate the oxidation state of central metal. If we get 3 now, then it's okay. If not, we're going to balance it here. So we know that ethane, that ethane 1-2 diene is neutral, so it's going to be X. So can you see this problem? So it's trying to tell you that this one here is positive 3, so we need negative 3 to counterize it here, right? So by the time you put 3 here, now let's calculate the oxidation, so it's going to be plus 3. So this one here is same thing with this. So that is the compound, right? That's the formula for the compound. The next, okay, as you know, the other part of the question, we are provided with the complex formula and we are to name the complex. Now the first thing you need to understand here, that the entire complex now is a cation, while this is an anion. Remember that this is not a ligand, it is just a counterion. So the first thing to do is to calculate the oxidation state of a central metal. We have X plus ammonia is usually a neutral, so multiply by 0, 6 times 0 is going to be 0 plus. We know that this chlorine here is minus 1, so we have minus 1 times 3. Remember that these counterions, whenever you're calculating the oxidation state of the central metal, they will be involved, right? So we have equals to 0. We have X minus 3 equals to 0, X equals to plus 3. So that's the oxidation state of the central metal. So now the ligand here is amine, because we're going to name the ligands first, then we'll name the entire cation first, before the anion. And in naming the cation, we have to name the ligands first. And in the ligand here, we have 6 of the amine, so that's hexaamine. So we have hexaamine, then we have cobalt. Cobalt what? What is the ion? What is the oxidation set? This one, cobalt 3. 3 what? Now the anion, so which is chloride. So that is the name of this complex, hexaamine cobalt 3 chloride. Let's check the next one. So this is the second complex we have to name. So the first thing to know is that this one is a cation while this is the anion. So we're going to name the complex first, and name the complex we have to calculate the oxidation state and know the ligands, because we're going to name the ligands in alphabetic order. So we have to say X. So this is the oxidation set of the central metal. So in naming the ligands, we know that we're going to name it in alphabetic order. So we have amine and we have chloro. So five of them, which will come first because it is A, and the chloro, which is C. So it's going to be pentaamine. Then we have chloro, pentaamine, chloro. Then the central metal, which is cobalt. Then oxidation state, which is 3. We have 1, 2, 3. Then we have chloride. So that is the complex name. So this is the last complex we have to name. So in this case, this is the cation and the entire complex now is the anion. So the central metal here is going to carry a Latin name and it's going to end up with ATE, right? So, but remember, still on that, the ligand will come first in naming it. But we have to name the cation first. So the cation here is potassium. But before doing that, let's calculate the oxidation state of central metal, which will be this one here is minus, we have positive 1, potassium is positive 1 times 3 is going to be 3. So this is the oxidation state of central metal. Then writing the cation first, so it will be potassium. Then we have 6 of the cyano, so it will be hexacyano. Now it's going to carry a Latin name from ferrium, but it's going to be end with ATE, so it will be ferret. Ferret. What the oxidation state is 3. Ferret. It will be ferret 3. So that's the name of this complex. So that's all for this question. So let's see the next question. Alright, the fifth question says that a six coordinate metal complex is formed by the following empirical equation. And the equation has been given here that the metal plus six ligands will give us metal with six ligands. Show that the B6 is equal to K1, K2, K3, K4, K5 and K6. I think I've solved a similar question that have to do with four coordinate system in my previous videos. You can also check it out. But since it's a question that we need to solve, then let's give it a try. So the best way to approach this, imagine a complex, right? With metal that have six ligands that is being formed by a single addition of these ligands at a step. How will the reaction B? So for the first step, we know that the first metal is going to react with a ligand and it's a reversible reaction. It's going to give us a metal and a ligand, right? So remember that there is what we call equilibrium constant in every reaction. An equilibrium constant usually is denoted by K and is actually the concentration of product all over the concentration of individual reactant. So assuming you have a reaction of A plus B to produce C. The equilibrium constant is going to be like this. The concentration of C all over the concentration of individual reactants, which is A and B. So in this case now, we have our first equilibrium constant. So it's going to be K now is equals to our product all over our individual reactant. So for the second step, we'll carry this product now and further react with a ligand. So as usual, we give us two ligands now, right? And this one is the second. So this one is first. So we have K2 is equals to our product. Second step, carry this, react it further with a ligand. Give you three now. So our K3 now is going to be. Then carry this, react it further. So our K4 is going to be. Then lastly, we'll carry it since we are looking for something like this, right? So it's going to be ML6. And the last equilibrium constant is going to be. So this is for reaction. Remember that this K1 are called the stepwise stability constant. The reactants are reacting to form products step by step. So there's another way of writing. Instead of adding this ligand singly step by step, we can use this method. We can now add the first step, the metal plus the ligand, the metal from plus the ligand, which will give us metal and ligand. Then we have now metal. Instead for us to carry this one and add it to ligand, we can do it directly to be two ligands now, and this one will give us what still give us something like this. Then the next one, we can use this plus three ligands, will give us the same thing. But in this case, now we're not going to say we are using equilibrium constant, we're going to use beta 1. What will be this beta 1? Of course, this beta 1 is going to be a concentration of product all over the concentration of reactant. The same thing, beta 2. This one will have square because it's actually multiplying, it's a molecule. So that is it, right? So since this one produced the same result with this, right? I see. So we can boldly say that B1 is equal to K1, K2. So and so on and forth. So therefore we can say B4 is same thing as K1. So that's the answer.